Welcome to the Startup Success Podcast for people interested in making useful and valuable software companies. Brought to you by MoreAware, makers of software for countertop fabricators. Visit moreaware.com/company to see if you're a fit for our team. Hey there. Bob and I try something a bit different with this show. Instead of reacting as much to Daniel and Michael from DrChrono in the moment, we decided to save our reactions and stories until after our conversation. That way we don't have to burden our guests with all the time it takes for us to share our wisdom and stories, and yet we still get to react to all the great things our guests tell us. So this is a bit of an experiment. Let us know if you like it or not. But this is Bob and I talking about our DrChrono interview immediately after that interview. Enjoy.
Hey there.
Hey. So these guys actually listen to our podcast. Again, I know obviously somebody does, but I just find it amazing that these super successful, you know, just crushing it entrepreneurs listen to us. I think that's really cool. I guess they listen to our guests, not us.
Well, okay. Yes, they do listen to our guests. But the thing I would like to just kind of remind you, Patrick, is that they're not alone. There are a lot of people we've interviewed that are listening to this podcast probably right now.
It's my
just because we do kind of ferret out little gems of usefulness for people.
Or gems of ferrets. I don't know. It's that imposter syndrome that I have. It's that thing.
Everybody has it.
Everyone talks about. Everyone does. You do something. Anytime I do something, I'm just kind of shocked that people like it.
I think it's gotten harder. It might be a factor of age, but I think it's because we're all so interconnected now that the imposter syndrome really is a major factor, because every time you try and like create something, you realize that there are 100,000 other people who are going to create and talk about what they do today as well. And maybe all of them are going to be better than you.
Yeah, and Michael and Daniel talked about, you know, certainly one of the best ways to dominate a market is to be first. Well, but I can't be first is what everyone says. But, you know, they found first in a certain category. They weren't the first healthcare startup.
They changed the rules.
Yes, they did.
I mean, but these, as Michael was saying,
that's hard.
Yeah, and the thing is, there have been companies in the business of doing the back office stuff, i.e., you know, going toe-to-toe against the insurance companies who routinely find ways of denying one-third of every, you know, one-third of the claims the doctors put in.
Medical billing companies. Yeah, medical billing companies are what those are called. Yeah. You know, it's a standard small business to medium business across the country.
There's a friend of mine who went to chiropractic school, became a chiropractor, had her own business, had her own practice. And she finally got out because she couldn't deal with the insurance companies anymore. They're driving her crazy.
Yeah.
So for them, it was more like, here's an opportunity we can be even more of service to our customers. And that turned into a major revenue opportunity.
Yeah.
And since they're bringing their, shall we say, technological focus to doing that, they can be a lot more efficient than the, you know, throw a thousand body type company at this sort of stuff. And it just strikes me that there's an interesting play there. All the technology in the world is not going to make people cooperate and do what they say. And eventually, the services part, you know, getting people to do what they said to do, like pay that bill or process that claim or whatever, that may become, you know, a major part of any entrepreneur's business.
I have an anecdote about this particular scenario. I didn't want to get sidetracked on this, but I was boiling inside as we were talking about this. I have a bunch of claims from last year that are on hold. I was talking with my wife at lunch because she's trying to unpack these stupid things. We have let me paint this picture. So last year, we had Blue Cross Blue Shield California. And this year, they canceled that particular policy. So now it's a different Blue Cross Blue Shield with a different name. Before joining Microsoft, I had Blue Cross Blue Shield Michigan. I happen to like Blue Cross Blue Shield. And there was more than one provider, more than one doctor of mine last year tried to submit claims to Blue Cross Blue Shield Michigan that I hadn't used in 3 years. So, and unwinding this is just unbelievably maddening because, you know, I've got doctors who want to get paid and I don't want to pay out of pocket when I had insurance, you know, but some medical billing provider messed it up. And so to have things, you know, and my doctors just roll their eyes. They just don't want to deal with it. So if they're, you know, if someone like DrChrono comes in and says, look, we're going to, I believe.
Makes the pain go away.
Yeah. And Michael said, we don't get paid till you get paid. Whoa, that they're making it work now. You know, just deal with it. Figure it out. I don't want to know the details. You're going to figure that out. That's a powerful message.
Well, you know, you think about it, and there's always been this little software niche called let our computers fight their computers.
Right.
And I would put, I'll put, you know, TurboTax at the top of that list.
Great ads this year, by the way. I mean, they're advertising. You don't watch. See, you don't like ads. This is what you miss out on. They had one of the best ad campaigns this year. Since you don't watch ads, I'm not going to tell you, but I'll send you some YouTube. But go on. Sorry.
I just think, you know, there's a couple of really solid pieces of opportunity in that interview we just did. One is these guys have got an API, and they are looking. They are looking for entrepreneurs to write business against that API.
Now, yes.
I happen to know another person who is in the medical supply business. They deal with the supplies that are in operating rooms. Mm-hmm. One of the things they have to deal with is skin grafts. Well, these things that look like, you know, basically sheets of paper, mm-hmm. they can cost $5,000 a piece.
Wow.
And they expire.
Wow.
And you don't want to be using expired skin grafts.
So that's a very specific that's a very specific inventory problem. Michael and Daniel were saying they want people to build inventory solutions. Boom.
Yeah. And you know, that's the beauty of an API world, if you will.
Yep.
It's not just that there may be one API, but there may be several APIs where you can get in the middle there and basically find value and make value.
That's super cool.
Go ahead.
Hey, okay. We're like the chipmunks. Let me unpack one other key thing about DrChrono's success. Michael and Daniel did start with who? They picked a specific set of customers. Okay, healthcare, but let's narrow it down further. Okay, doctor practices, even further, ambulatory doctor practices, meaning doctor practices not in a hospital. They were very specific right from the beginning who they were going for, and then they even said, okay, we're going to start at the low end of these. We're going to start with small practices who didn't otherwise have solutions. And as they said, a business like that, when they first came out 7 years ago, they looked like a feature. It was an iPad app. What a nice little toy. Then a couple years later, they get Y Combinator, one thing leads to another, $8 million in investment, keep going, more and more customers. That's your toehold into a potentially much larger business, yet their core customer segment is still the same. They're still going after that same set of customers, delivering better and better solutions, now adding services, as you said. It all started out with picking the customer. So API is one part. You can, if you don't have a grand vision or don't want a grand vision or want to build a modest business, just build on someone else's platform, whether that's Facebook or Apple or DrChrono. Use one of these APIs and build on it. If you want to build something, some grand vision, you have to at least choose who are going to be your customers and find one thing they want, one feature, and build out from there.
But it's not enough to just be better. You've got to really have leverage at that point. And let me explain
leverage?
What I mean.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that when DrChrono started, was it basically the same time that Obamacare got going?
Sure.
And the non-consumer part of that is the whole push toward precision medication, and not even that, just decent electronic record keeping. So one of the things they started to do, the federal government, they started to squeeze the balls of the medical industry and saying, okay, either we can incent you to do this, so here's our carrots, or we're going to start bashing you on the head.
Right.
Which would you prefer? Because there have been, you know, umpteen companies that have come and gone promising back to the days when they were building off of, you know, Microsoft this and Microsoft that to, automate their medical practice. And they just never got there, okay? The only ones who got there were like the really giant companies who could hammer at a large organization long enough to the point where they say, okay, fine, we'll give you a $1 billion contract. Just leave us alone.
Right.
And the thing is, it was an opportunity that these guys jumped on, not just with the technology, because the technology was cool, and that, you know, that got my eye because, you know, I was in love with the iPad and still am. But the doctors out, they knew their market from the get-go, that doctors are in some ways extremely conservative, which is good because then they don't, you know, kill off 20% of their patients every few months with their brand new toy that they have. But these doctors, they had to change. They weren't really given much in the way of a choice.
Yeah.
So and that's an important lesson.
And also, as Daniel and Michael alluded to at the end of our interview, you don't get too arrogant because things can change underneath your feet. What if we have a different administration after this next election that totally changes the ground beneath their feet and they have to scramble? Now, they're successful enough that they have the resources to make the change, but it certainly is, there's always an opportunity in their industry to have these massive shifts that either could, you know, cost them a lot of money in required new development or give an opportunity to another investor, DrChrono 2, to another entrepreneur, and who could come in and respond faster than they could. So it's a tough industry, but...
You know, it's actually, I'm going to point to this as an example of like one of my core values, which is history matters. You have to know what the bigger context of things are. These guys knew from watching the healthcare industry that the time was right for what they were going to do. Not just the pretty toy iPad thing, but just what they were really trying to bring, which is, you know, basically end-to-end automation of everything but the medicine in a medical practice.
Yeah.
And they didn't get that by just focusing on, you know, the shiny new technology. They got from seeing the perspective of what they're doing with the context of where they are. I would submit that since, for better or worse, we tend to be going faster and faster as things change, or things are changing faster and faster, that there are, you know, for all the people out there who are saying, oh, but everything's been done, all the good opportunities have been taken, it's already been built by somebody else. Take another look, because there are changes happening, you know, every day, every month, every year. And these changes are going to open new doors. And, you know, maybe that's the door you get to go through.
No, I think that is very true. Very true. That I'm sure we used the Wayne Gretzky cliche in one of our past interviews with them. You've got to skate to where the puck's going, not to where the puck is. You've got to kind of keep an eye on the industry and on an industry. And
I think that's like a Michigan sort of thing rather than a California thing, but hey, I digress.
No, he was the LA Kings. He brought hockey to LA. So there you go.
Don't you require ice for a hockey?
They can make ice anywhere. One more thing to unpack about these guys. You'll notice that when we talked about the service business that they added, they didn't have a vision for that at the beginning. At least that was the impression I got. So even with that context, even with seeing where the puck is going, not where it is, they kept talking to their customers. They kept finding out what else can we do? What's next? What's most important?
Well, and they evolved. They did 10 experiments.
And well, this was, yeah, there you go.
Was just the one of them.
Yeah. Did they say the other 9 didn't work or just this one worked the best?
I got the feeling this one worked the best. I didn't get, they weren't, you know, we didn't get into the detail about,
right,
you know, each and every one of those, though they did mention that the idea of experimenting was something they picked up at Y Combinator.
Right.
And, you know, obviously it worked for these guys. I will say, though, because I have this discussion at the startup I work at more than a few times, experimenting is good. Experimenting is a good way to find out things. However, you also have to have a vision of where you are trying to take the company and where it's going and what you're bringing to the world. And you cannot wait for the market to tell you, because then what they're going to tell you is, hey, it's too bad you didn't do it like those other guys.
Yeah, an experiment without a hypothesis is just playing around. You've got to be pointed somewhere.
Well, you got to, and I think that it's even more than that. You have to have a vision, because in some ways it's all about the differentiation. I mean, in one way, I mean, technology has become in some ways the ultimate commodity. You know, digits don't cost anything. Electrons cost nothing. But it's the vision of what you're doing, the focus you bring to it, the values you bring to it that, you know, make company A this way and company B, you know, the other way, and firing off its staff and sharing and selling its errand chairs. You know, it's about vision. And, you know, I guess I'd say that the one thing that struck me about these guys is that they were very pragmatic.
Mm-hmm.
Pragmatic and persevering. They mentioned they'd gone through more than a few oh shit moments. Do we have a company tomorrow?
Right.
And they kept coming back. I think the point, you know, the adage that I think it was Michael said of, you know, things are never as bad as they seem and they never are as good as they seem.
Right.
Is a good one. Is that, you know, our industry is not known for its, you know, deep perspective on the world events and the world around them. It's always, you know, that's just not the way most entrepreneurs and technologists act. But yeah, maybe they should.
I don't know. Hey, one other quick kudos to DrChrono is their branding is impressive. It really sticks in your head, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I can't remember if they gave that a lot of thought, but I like
They've
it.
They've always had a good website. They've always had, you know, I mean, part of it is the reality that, you know, when people take a look at something new and they're trying to decide if they're going to spend any more time on this new thing or go on to the next new thing, the way things look is important. The attractiveness of the message and the medium matter. Again, that's another thing that especially technical founders seem to be under the impression that, oh, it doesn't matter if it's ugly. Well, yeah, it does matter.
It does matter. There can be a progression. So at Moreware, we're working on some pretty extensive user interface improvements. Mm-hmm. And Nick DeSabato, who I interviewed, has been helping us. He's kind of awesome. And right now, on some internal stuff that we're using to see if these changes are going to work, it's ugly. But the customers will never see that. But it's the process of improving it can go through this part where it's ugly. But by the time it reaches customers, it's going to be pretty. Now, again, we have enough of a business that we can't afford to have something ugly at all. If you're doing an experiment, that's one thing to see, hey, do people like this? But even then, people respond emotionally to visuals. I'd rather have someone have something pretty that was a total mess behind the scenes than have something just great behind the scenes that was ugly, you know, even if you're experimenting. Well,
they'll never get there because, I mean, I would submit that people today end up making, let's say from now to back, you know, all the way back to 2006, which really isn't that long ago. But in those 10 years, I'd say the number of decisions that people have to make from the time they open their eyes and yeah. the time they turn, you know, they turn the lights off, I'd say it's 10 times more. Now, many of those decisions are insignificant, unimportant, and are, you know, they won't even be remembered the next day, but we are in a world where we make many, many, many more decisions. And you know what? Very seldom do you go back and revisit a decision.
I agree. Well, we ran an experiment as well. I don't know if people hate this, let me know, but I think this was a success. We made a conscious decision after a previous interview to try to leave more air for our guests, let them talk while we were interviewing them, and then immediately afterward, record us talking. I like this. I thought this was, I'm a little exhausted because it's quite late in my day, but I liked this little post-interview discussion to get out those rest of the thoughts that I had, and I know you always have. I felt like it let us kind of complete the thought without burdening our guests.
Yeah, I like not being in competition with our guests.
Right.
For, you know, the urge to be able to say something witty.
Right.
And I also like the idea that it gives us a few minutes to just sort of ruminate over what our guests said and what
stroke our chest.
At least we thought was the most important part of it.
Yeah, and also try to relate it back to people. You know, again, these guys, Dr. Crono, Michael and Daniel, are enormously successful. And more than I'll ever be in my life. So being able to relate some of what they're saying back to the beginning where they were 7 years ago, they're no longer there. It's probably hard for them to see that. I hope that we can bring some of that spirit of beginning back, because that's kind of the part that I care about most is what is it like for someone saying, yeah, that's what I want to do. What's the first step?
Well, I'd like to believe that it's something you can do at any age.
Yep.
As I stare my birthday coming up in the face.
39 holding?
Yeah, we're holding. that's the edge of the cliff and you hold on. But I do think that it's more a matter of attitude and that you are where you are. And yeah, there are going to be advantages and disadvantages, but it's kind of like writing code. If you put thought into it before you do it, you can do a 10x better job of it just by thinking about it.
Yep.
And I don't think that the door slams shut on the startup world, you know, at age 26. I know that's how it's often portrayed in the media, but the media is full of shit to begin with. Okay, I take that from somebody who knows. I do think that as things change, there are going to be so many more opportunities for people who just are willing to, you know, open up their eyes, look around the world as it is now, not the way it used to be, and find places where they can help people.
I completely agree. I have the balancing factor of that is I have less ambition than I used to have, but that's okay. I think it helps me be more honest with myself and see the world in a more realistic light. And who knows? I have no idea where that will lead. I'm just I'm enjoying the ride and enjoying these topics. So I'm gonna go eat. Thank you, my friend.
Take care.
Always a pleasure. Talk to you soon.
Bye bye.
Thanks for listening to the Startup Success Podcast with Bob Walsh and Patrick Foley. Be sure to subscribe to the show on iTunes, like our Facebook page, and follow us on Twitter. And then go build a useful and valuable software company.